Hi everyone, we're going to give it just a couple minutes for the session to start. We opened up the room a touch early, but that's a good chance for everyone to get in here and we can start our program probably at 1 Eastern. Okay, and while it's going, I'll mention this again soon in a few minutes as well, but we do have a captioning service we use with our C2C CARE webinars. There's been a link placed in the chat below, which allows you to link out to where the captions are happening. The Zoom captioning is acting a little wonky today, so we're providing an outside source for you guys to keep track of it if you're interested in watching the closed captioning at the same time. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen to get started. Excellent, okay. So let me start by welcoming everyone today to this newest C2C CARE webinar about Collections Management Policy Toolkit with our partners over at CCAHA. Just to start, I'm gonna remind you, I'm gonna go through some programming notes and then we're gonna get into today's program pretty quickly. My name is Robin Bauer-Kilgo and I am the C2C CARE coordinator. I am located just outside of Washington, D.C. in Silver Spring, Maryland, so I welcome everyone to post maybe in the chat where they're located, how the weather's going. I know here in the D.C. area, we are a touch smoky because of some wildfires happening up in Quebec, so we hope if anyone's coming into us from that area, they are doing okay right now. If you are new to our program, this is our home on the web, connecting to collectionscare.org. Connecting to collections.org. On that website, you are going to see a complete archive of our program. C2C CARE has been around since the early 2010s, basically. So there's quite a resources of past webinars and past courses that we've done. So I would encourage you to go around in there and click around if you can to kind of see what's been happening. We also have our curated resources and a link to our community, which is a moderated community and can be quite helpful for when people want to ask a question and kind of get an answer from a wonderful group of people who help moderate and monitor the community. So I welcome you to click around and see what you can find on that website. We also have two places on the web that you can find us. They are on social media, on Facebook and Twitter. For both of those, just look up at C2C CARE and you should be able to find us. You'll see all sorts of news announcements about upcoming programming on there. So I encourage you to go check out those as well. Couple technical notes before we started today's program. This is a Zoom webinar, so you will be able to access the chat box to say hello, which it looks like people are doing that. So I am glad that's working well. We also have a Q&A box. That's a chance for you to actually ask questions of our presenters today. So I would encourage you to put questions in the Q&A box. If you put them in the chat, they could potentially get lost in the stream of consciousness that is the Zoom chat. So again, if you have a question, put it in the Q&A box. We'll get to as many as we can by the end of today's program. I also mentioned that we do have a transcription and captioning happening for this webinar. For the captioning, you will want to access a link. I'll put it in there again. There's an outside link we're using today because the Zoom is acting a little wonky. So we're using that service instead. So just click on that and you'll be able to see some runtime happening on there at the same time. Upcoming programming note, we have figured out our summer programming, which I'm very excited about. So we have programming now going to the earliest of September for C2C CARE. It's a free webinar. Again, you can go in and register right now on our website. July 19th, we'll be doing CARE of tin mercury amalgam mirrors, which should be a really interesting subject. A lot of people have these types of mirrors or types of objects within their collection. So you'll be able to find out a little bit about CARE about it. In August, you'll be learning about how to manage volunteers and collections, which can be an interesting subject dealing with volunteers and collections. We usually have delightful people who help us in collections. Who wants to volunteer, but we're going to be hearing someone who specializes in volunteer management to maybe give us some tips and tricks on how to deal with them within the collection sphere. And then in early September, we'll be covering arsenic in collections. There's a lot of objects out there that have arsenic in them. If anyone went to the recent AIC conference in Jacksonville, there were a couple of really good sessions on that. So in that session, we'll be learning about maybe some ways to detect arsenic, some how to handle them, and just some really good information about arsenic and collections. So I encourage you to register for those free programs whenever you have a chance. Now I'm going to go ahead and get over to our presenter today. I'm going to stop sharing our screen. We actually have two presenters today, both from CCAHA. Dyani Feige and Alanna Shaffer are going to be talking to us about the Collections Management Policy Toolkit, which we're really excited to hear about because I always love to hear about these kind of programs and objects out there that people can build these fun policies that we've heard all about. So without further ado, I'm going to hand this over to Dyani, and I will see you at the end during the Q&A. Feel free to take over whenever you're ready.
All right. Hello, everyone. Hopefully you can see my screen. I'm going to turn off my video while I'm presenting. So thank you, Robin. Thank you to all of the audience for joining us today. As Robin mentioned, my name is Dyani Feige. I'm the Director of Preservation Services at the Conservation Center for Art and Historic Artifacts. And I am also, as Robin mentioned, I'm joined today by my coworker, Alanna Shaffer, who is the Preservation Services Operations Manager. And we are going to share with you about a free online tool that we at the Conservation Center have developed with an Institute for Museum and Library Services National Leadership Grant. The tool intends to help streamline the process of collecting organizations writing collections management policies. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the background and creation of the tool. Alanna is going to do a walkthrough of some of the functions of the website and the tool itself, and then we will have plenty of time for questions. In case anyone is not familiar with us, a quick note about our organization, the Conservation Center for Art and Historic Artifacts, or CCAHA. We are a regional conservation lab and preservation services facility. Our conservators specialize in paper-based items, including books, photographs, and work on paper. We also offer digitization services, fundraising assistance, housing, framing, and more. And our preservation services staff, of which Alanna and I are both part, work in the field providing education programs and helping institutions plan for the future of their collections. We're based in Philadelphia, but we work with organizations and clients all throughout the country and internationally as well. I was looking through the chat. It's great to see some folks from outside of the US joining us today. So hello. And you can learn more about us and what we do at our website, which is just ccaha.org. Here's a sneak preview of the toolkit homepage, which you'll get to know a lot more in a few minutes. So as far as background, why bother with collections policies? I suspect I'm preaching to the choir if you're joining us today, but just so we're all on the same page, the highly complex process of acquiring, financing, caring for, exhibiting, teaching about, and sometimes deaccessioning collections requires good policies. I think it's fair to say that you are all here because you work with an institution or are affiliated with collections, some entity that holds collections. You hold these collections in trust for the public, and that requires you to maintain the highest legal, ethical, and professional standards. This involves the way that we actually do this is by establishing policies that guide the institution's operations and to delegate specific responsibilities to staff, volunteers, and other individuals through those policies. Collections management policies are created to define a systematic approach to all aspects of collections care within an institution. They are a consolidated set of policies that address all of the various components of collections management, including all of the topics here that you see up on the screen. These policies clarify who is responsible for managing the collections. They govern what a collecting institution does to care for and grow its collections and how it makes them available to the public. Most of the professional associations like the American Alliance of Museums, the Society of American Archivists, et cetera, recommend that every collecting institution invest in the creation of these documents. So really, to kind of boil it down, a good collections management policy is a detailed statement of why an institution is in operation and how it goes about its business. So understanding the importance of collections management policies, a little bit more about our journey to working so directly with them. Through previous IMLS funding, CCAHA did a series of statewide surveys in a program called Connecting to Collections that ran in the late 2000s and early 2010s. We conducted surveys throughout as many collecting institutions as we could track down in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and West Virginia. And our findings about collections management policies are up here on the screen. So you can say, you know, for Pennsylvania, 70% of respondents stated that assistance with these types of policies would be useful or very useful. The numbers, particularly for New Jersey and West Virginia, don't look so bad until you realize that this is how many organizations had no policies at all, let alone policies that were complete, up to date, et cetera. So nearly 40% in both of those states. So just to kind of jump back to some of the reasons, both big picture and day-to-day practical, that it is really important to have these policies in place. They can be effective in raising appreciation for collections care at higher levels of the institution, including the board of directors or board of managers, by reminding everyone of the important daily tasks of collections stewardship and preservation. They are sometimes required as attachments in grant applications, particularly federal grants, and are essential for recognition such as AAM museum accreditation, a process that many museums and historic sites may be technically eligible to pursue, but postpone doing because of the intimidating rigor of the process. Collections management policies can also be key documents in loan negotiations between museums. A museum without a strong collection management policy is at risk for being unable to accommodate some loan requests, rendering their collections less accessible. When we worked with organizations on other preservation projects, from preservation needs assessments to emergency planning initiatives, we kept discovering time and time again that even if in the beginning it seemed like they did have some form of collections management policy, perhaps putting them in the category to tick yes on that connecting to collections survey, so many of them were out of date, incomplete, not well shared or understood throughout the organization, and any number of other reasons, they just were not really effective tools for actually determining collections care and management decisions. Let me just take one more, I promise this is the last one, small sidestep for a second and tell you about a program we have run in the Philadelphia region since 2002 with funding from the William Penn Foundation. The basic goal of the Philadelphia Stewardship Program is to work with institutions over time to not only inform them about collections care needs and recommendations, but actually try to help with follow through and implementation. The program is set up in a series of tracks for organizations to work through in an iterative fashion. So preservation needs assessments are track one, preservation plans are track two, risk assessments are track three. And in 2009, we introduced the then newest track to the program based on our findings from those surveys and our previous experience, track four, in which we would directly assist organizations in writing collections related policies, particularly collections management policies. So leading up to applying for this grant between 2009 and 2015, we worked with 15 institutions on drafting these policies, from initial decisions on scope through board of directors approval. By working with these organizations, we observed the decision-making processes that are most likely to stall the process, the policy sections that are the most universal in nature, the importance of customizing policies to support the unique needs of the types of materials collected by the particular institution, and other areas that tend to require the greatest focus and customization. These direct observations led us to the conclusion that the process could be adapted into an online tool for creating customized templates. And this is really building upon the approach kind of pioneered by the Northeast Document Conservation Center and the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners with their widely used D-Plan for the development of emergency response plans. I know there is a newer version of this out now, so definitely check that out as well. And also sharing similar navigation functions with popular software programs such as TurboTax. By no way is this presentation intended to laud TurboTax in particular. It just happens to be a commonly known software tool that you can kind of work through at your own pace and build a product. So we applied to the National Leadership Grant through IMLS in 2017 to build a tool to achieve these goals. And we were very excited and fortunate to learn that our request was awarded in full, with work to begin in 2018. Much of the first year of that grant was spent meeting and collaborating with the web development team we partnered with, the Philadelphia-based, women-owned and operated firm, YIKES. We had a number of branding discussions. They built us some excellent skeletons and work on getting the site itself ready, chugged along behind the scenes before we had actively developed much of the content itself. While YIKES had not built sites that were exactly similar, we really liked that they had built a number of tool-based sites in other disciplines focused on inputting information and providing results. For example, they built an online tool for the University of Pennsylvania's OncoLink, a resource for creating cancer survivorship content that could be used to develop custom cancer survivorship care plans. So completely different application, field, purpose, outcome, everything, but still these fairly complex levels of inputting some information and coming out with a plan in place. We convened an advisory committee in person in early 2019. The advisory committee consisted of individuals who were had contributed a great deal to the field of policy-related work. So Rebecca A. Buck and Jean Gilmore, who worked together in consulting, John Herbert, who has since retired, but was then a digital preservation specialist with Lyrisys, and John Simmons, who wrote the well-known text on creating collections policies, Things Great and Small. So during this meeting, we covered the topics. We worked to try and define the user, worked on identifying sections to include in the tool, and did a preliminary SWOT analysis of the toolkit in concept. And then throughout the rest of 2019, we worked on developing content. So putting together questions and answers and potential language that would actually be input into the tool. We all, of course, know what 2020 brought, and for the toolkit, this meant the beginning of some major cascading delays due to staffing, competing priorities, and the like. I won't make you watch that much longer. We did get back on track eventually, though, reassembling the advisory committee through a series of virtual meetings and lengthy email threads. A great deal of work went into developing and refining the content, but really there's not much more to talk about here that makes it exciting. Basically, we took a few of the collections management policies we had written with different types of institutions and really broke them apart into a series of questions and answers. Because we wanted to make this tool as widely useful as possible, we have to think of a range of different types of circumstances and situations that might be applicable responses to the questions. This took a great deal of internal testing by a number of CCAHA staff, as well as ongoing input from the advisory committee. When we had tested it, upon testing it internally, we sprung it out a bit further into the world for 15 beta tester institutions, representing a wide cross-section of types of collections, size of organizations, existence or not of previous policies. We digested and incorporated their feedback and finally put together something that has been extensively tested, tweaked, and fine-tuned with a launch to the public last November 2022. So it is indeed out in the world. And now Alanna is going to share her screen for a bit of a walkthrough. So let me just stop sharing mine.
Thanks so much, Dyani. Hi, everyone. I am going to get my screen share going. But as Dyani mentioned, and I'm hoping someone will shout if you can't hear me or if there's any issues with the screen share, but hopefully this all looks good. Let me log out so we can. As Dyani mentioned, my name is Alanna Shaffer, and my pronouns are she, her, and I am the Preservation Services Operations Coordinator here at CCAHA. So now that Dyani has given you some background on the toolkit and the process we went through in creating it, we thought it would be useful to actually show you what the website looks like and sort of what the process would be as an actual user of the CMP toolkit. So here we are at the starting point, which is cmptoolkit.org. So this is home not just to the toolkit itself, but also a number of other great resources, both about using the toolkit as well as other resources more generally about collections management policy and policy development. And I am actually going to also stop my video so we can all just focus here on the website. So the heart of the CMP toolkit really is this questionnaire. So this is where you will answer a series of questions, and those questions will ultimately be fed into the policy template we've created. And I lost my place, of course. So those answers will ultimately be fed into the policy template we've created to generate your final collections management policy. But there are a couple things you can do before even diving into the questionnaire. So even before you create an account, if you'd like, so that you can really help prepare for this process and be best set up for success. So obviously one of those things is to just sort of review all of the instructional content that we've provided, which you'll find here in this menu under the CMP toolkit. We've made this page using the CMP toolkit, which is a really detailed step-by-step instructional guide, but we also have this quick start guide for a more zoomed out look at the process of getting started. We also have this questionnaire overview and content guide page that we created. This is essentially a preview of the kind of information that you'll be asked to provide once you get to the questionnaire. One thing we found during beta testing was that a lot of institutions didn't have existing policies for some of the things that we ask about in the questionnaire. So the idea behind this page was just to give that heads up, so folks have a sense of what's going into this questionnaire ahead of time, and there's an opportunity then to gather that information, maybe write and approve new policies if need be, just generally getting all those collections ducks in a row before diving in. So all that being said, we're going to imagine I've got all my policies and important info at the ready, and then it would be time to create an account. So I will log out of my existing account for a moment so you can see what the page looks like when you're not logged in. You can click that Get Started button and just fill out some information about your organization to get going. So with that, I will log right back in and be brought to my dashboard. There's a number of places I can navigate to from here. I can make changes to that organizational information I just entered. Another thing I can do is add additional users onto the account. The CMP toolkit was really designed to be collaborative. So if you add someone here, they'll get an email invite to join the account and will get full permissions to view and edit the questionnaire. So it can be a truly collaborative process. Okay, so with that, I think we are ready to check out our main act, which of course is that questionnaire. So as you can see up top here, the questionnaire is divided into 11 sections, which will ultimately make up those sections of your completed policy. And these might include multiple choice checkboxes or short answer questions. I'll just sort of scroll through to give a quick preview of what that questionnaire or one of the sections of the questionnaire page would look like. Now, at any point, you can also save your progress while you're going through by just scrolling down to the bottom of a section and hitting save. We don't really have a great estimate for how long we anticipate this whole process taking because it will really depend on the organization and collection, but we can pretty safely say we don't anticipate you will complete it all in one sitting. So thankfully you can save your progress at any point and return to finish. So I mostly have my policy filled out or my questionnaire filled out, but I left a couple questions unanswered in this section here so I could point out a couple of things. So you'll notice first that most questions have instructions like this below the question that tell you if your answers should be in complete sentences or fill in the blank. And that's because these answers are being dropped into that pre-existing template. So the structure and phrasing really matters. In addition to the instructions, we've also provided sample text. Let me scroll down to an empty or an unanswered question at the bottom here, and you'll see this grayed out sort of text in the box. This actually will go away as soon as I start typing something. But the idea here is to just sort of give an example, not so much of what to say, but how to say it. So you can get a sense of what your final answer will look and sound like when it's in the context of the full policy and how it will make sense. So if I go to any of the other sections that I have completed up here, you will see this button up at the top that says View Preview. So this is a way that you can see exactly how. So even though we give you those extra hints and stuff, you can also just go look at a preview of that policy section and see exactly in bold here where your answers will populate and sort of how that will all be formatted and how it will read in the final version. But it's just important to note that that button will not appear until a section is complete, which is why we did not see it over here. So let's finish this section. And do some copy paste. We'll save that. And now I'm at 100%. And I have that ability to preview this section. We really do recommend doing this preview as you complete each section because some of these smaller errors might be harder to catch and just generally more annoying to go back and fix once you've finished all 11 sections and exported them all into a final policy. So you can sort of check as you go and then know once you export the final version altogether that everything is as it should be. Now, if you do happen to catch an error in that preview, you just scroll on down, hit edit section, and it's going to take you right back to that questionnaire editing page. Okay, so let's say you've completed all the required questions and everything looks good to go. You've checked every section preview. So we are ready to head to view policy where it confirms that 11 of 11 sections are completed. Just like that view preview button, this ability to view your policy will not appear if you haven't completed all the sections. So from here, we have a couple options for what to do next. Say you've viewed all the sections, everything is perfect and exactly the policy you want. You can just click download policy document and give it a moment and it should appear. There we go. Beautiful. So this is ready to go, ready to print or save as a PDF. But let's say there's something really unique to your collection or institution that we didn't ask about, but you know needs to be part of your final policy. If that's the case, we've actually also added this option to open your policy as an editable document in Google Drive. So because I'm already logged into a Google account, it kind of easily pops up for me. But you can just select that button and it's going to bring up that PDF in Google. But if you hit open in Google Docs, not everyone has a Microsoft Word. So this was the hopefully open source somewhat alternative to creating this editable version of your policy that you can now customize to your heart's content. All right, so that was a lot. And if you ever feel overwhelmed by this process, let me stop my screen share and come back up. If you ever do feel overwhelmed by this process, I just want to make sure, I wasn't supposed to stop screen sharing yet. There were a couple more, more things I wanted to show everyone. So I just wanted to make folks aware of those additional resources I mentioned at the top that we've also made available on the CMP Toolkit website. So one of those pages is a lost menu. You can go to our additional resources page here, and this is a pretty robust bibliography of sources, both about the CMPs overall, but it also breaks everything down section by section. I'll particularly point out a couple of the resources we put together for the tool up at top here. One is a glossary, a sort of quick reference glossary of terms that will come up in the questionnaire. And we also have a full sample policy. So while we hope the instructions and the sample text and all of that will make things easy, you also have this full sample policy to go check out if you just want to see exactly what that complete document is going to look like and how your answers will fit into that final export. Now, last but not least, we also have a couple options for assistance that goes beyond what you'll find just on the website. So we'll head over to additional support. So if you have more complicated questions specific to your collection or are struggling to get through a specific question, CCAHA staff is also available to review your policy and provide direct feedback for an additional charge. So if you're interested in purchasing this extra support, you just need to head to this page. Let's see, there's a couple of different options of support that we offer. And you can schedule a time to meet directly with CCAHA staff for that sort of one-on-one discussion of your policy. This is also where you can go if you need to upgrade your membership after 1 year. So this is when I'll mention that the CMP Toolkit is a free tool. It's totally free to create an account, but we do ask folks to upgrade to a paid subscription if they need to continue to access the account after 1 year, which is really just a $1 a month fee to cover the cost of extended storage. All right, now is when I can stop screen sharing because that is it for the walkthrough. But before we call it a day, we wanted to also give you opportunities to ask questions, but we also imagine that some of your questions might overlap with ones that have already come up a few times in this process, especially through the beta testing process. So we put together a brief FAQ to walk through first to see if we can't address some of those up front, and then we'll jump into the questions in the Q&A. So I will just sort of walk through the questions that we've put here. So one that came up a lot is just what kind of organization is this geared towards? And really the intention when we put it together was for small and mid-sized institutions that either have never a CMP or have a really out of date one that needs a little updating. Easy and straightforward to use regardless of staff background or how much experience folks have in policy development, which is why we really wanted to add all of those extra resources, the glossary, and really make it a just step-by-step walkthrough of the process. Next one, can this be used to update or revise an old CMP? Yes and no was sort of the conclusion we came to. The intention was yes. We did have a beta tester who said, you know, ours was, it really just needed some tweaking. So going through the whole questionnaire process was maybe not the most useful. There's certainly still a lot of benefit, I think, to using the site for all the resources and additional materials that are provided. And certainly if you're updating, but more or less starting over because something is very out of date, then I think the questionnaire could be still very functional for that reason. Okay, so this next one sort of gets to what I was talking about with the editable document. So our organization has a complex structure or unique collection that needs, whose needs aren't addressed in the questionnaire. Can we still make use of this tool? So this definitely came up a lot in beta testing, and we actually didn't have the option to do the editable document before. We just had it straight to PDF, and that question came up, and so we adapted in response. So the idea being you can still use it, get that core information that really needs to be in there. And then you can change over to an editable doc to add in whatever specifics and customization you might need to really make it adapted to your institution. We tried to predict every kind of institution and collection and make sure we could address those needs. But obviously, there's just going to be some, it's a tool that is meant to be sort of one size for all. There just might need to be additional things added to really make sure it fits and addresses everything your organization needs. Okay, and last, definitely the biggest thing that came up in beta testing, which was our organization doesn't have a certain policy written yet. Can we skip that question for now? Or this whole particular section doesn't apply to my organization, can I skip it? All of the questions that are marked as required in the questionnaire need to be answered in order to have that button pop up and export your final policy. And almost all of the questions that you'll see in there are marked as required, but this was done purposely because these are things we think that you can't have a really complete policy without. So this is part of the reason why we created that question overview and content guide. So you don't have to dive in and be on a roll and then realize, oh, we don't have a housekeeping policy and it's asking about that. So now I have to pause and deal with that and figure it out and get off track. So we wanted to lay out all those sort of policies that you need so you can collect or write them if you have to, because we really don't want folks just skipping something if they don't have it, because that is a policy that is a key part of having a complete collections management policy. So of course, we also have that option to save your progress as you go through or jump around. You don't have to do those sections in order. You can hop around as needed. So you can always just save and come back to something later, which is what we'd recommend rather than having an incomplete policy. Make sure I addressed anything. The editable document also sort of answers that second question of if a particular section doesn't apply. So if there really is a question or a section that is just totally irrelevant to your collection or organization, then of course you still have that option to edit after the fact and remove anything that just isn't applicable. So that is our FAQ, and hopefully that answered some of what might come up in the Q&A now, but I imagine there are also other things. I haven't gotten a chance to open up this Q&A box yet, but I'm looking forward to it. So thanks so much for letting me share our tool.
Thank you. That was great. That was a great overview. And that FAQ, you did hit some of the questions that are in the Q&A box, but there's a good chance we'll revisit them. So if we have time, I might hit them again, just as a heads up. But thank you for putting that together, because that was really nice to kind of see it. Also earlier, I put the direct link to the toolkit in the chat. So if people want to go ahead and click on that, they're more than welcome to. And I also put in the chat that the slides are available from this presentation on our website. So heads up on that as well. So I'm going to start looking at some of the Q&A questions, and then we can kind of go from there to see kind of where the conversation takes us. This question is more just about collections management policies, but I thought it was interesting because I feel the same way a lot, where sometimes it's just like, where do you start, right? So when it says, when it comes to size and budget, I always get stymied. Do I use the information about my parent institution, or just what is the actual size and budget for the collections unit they work within? And I think this happens to a lot of people, right? There's a bigger organization and then you're a unit within the bigger organization. So what would be your advice for someone working within that kind of scope?
I can jump in. So I think typically if we're Well, I think in this question, it says specifically says special collections unit. So I'm not sure if that is, you know, within a university library or an academic library. I would say it depends on the situation, and it depends on the impact of that overall institutional infrastructure and budget on your collection. So if we really are talking about like a special collections unit within a large academic institution, the overall budget of the college or university, I mean, sure, that like aspects of that can touch the special collections, but I think it's a lot more important to look at like the departmental unit budget and size, et cetera. But there might be cases in which, you know, in which you it is important to reflect the overall budget. I think that's one of those that's just kind of a on a case by case basis. But I will say, like, when for budget in particular, and for like staff size in particular, I think we are probably mostly concerned with that particular department or unit.
Yeah, and the only thing I would add is, and this happens to me more when I'm helping out folks with writing emergency plans, is that you, like, even let's say you write your policy or your plan, and maybe your institution is kind of a bigger question. Your institution has this other policy and plan they work alongside, but there's like a larger one. I personally think it's okay to have these smaller plans or policies that deal just with your unit, but you still need to make sure they refer to each other and they talk to each other. You can't have this like little island of a policy that's like, cool, cool, big university. Like, you have your thing, but you know, they still have to communicate a little bit and refer to each other and make sure you're not contradicting each other, for sure. That'd be the only other thing I'd add to that.
that's a really good point.
This is interesting because you guys did talk about multiple users, which I think is an absolute wonderful thing, right? Is that that people can go in and kind of give their thoughts, because writing a policy by yourself is like the loneliest job known to mankind. So I love that there's a collaboration tool on it. But this person says, can different people from the same institution complete the questionnaire and compare results? So have you had any examples of that?
I can jump in on this, because when you create an account and add an additional user onto your institution, you're basically all working off that same questionnaire. So actually, the one caveat we give with folks can be in there working at the same time, but we advise it to not people to not be in there working on the same section at the same time, because if you both hit save, it might override one another. So you could, however, just create two separate accounts rather than, you know, adding someone on and working off that same account. You could, in theory, just create two separate accounts and both work on the questionnaire, and then, you know, sort of compare your previews or your export. So that would be possible.
Yeah, it would be. I mean, just to you with creating a free account, you can use it however you want, but I would say maybe that might be useful as like an exercise for one particular section or something. I don't think it would, it's a lengthy process. So I don't know that you would want to do that for the entire policy. So if there is like a particular section that is, there's been a lot of discussion around, you know, how do we handle these types of questions, then yeah, maybe like as an exercise. But I think it's in the collaborative function is intended to be, well, collaborative rather than, you know, keeping the accounts separate. So.
Excellent. Thank you. This is a question, just because this does come up a lot with working on these online platforms. Is the information private once entered? Does CCAHA have access to the info we've entered to generate our policies?
It is, it all just lives on the website back end. So I believe if we needed to access it for backup purposes. If someone got locked out of their account or something, there's other ways we can just help you get back in first, but it exists on the server, but our team at YIKES definitely was considering privacy and security in the storage of this data. And then, as I mentioned, after a year, if you don't decide to upgrade the account, that all of the data will just get deleted if you decide you don't need your account anymore. So that's not just going to be living in some server in perpetuity.
Gotcha. Perfect. I'll just have you repeat this because someone asked it. They asked if the toolkit free or do you have to be a client? So do you mind repeating kind of what the terms are for the use?
Sure. Sure. Yeah. So it's totally free to create an account and free for 1 year. And at that point, we will send you many, many reminders leading up to the end of that 1 year. But 1 year after the date you created your account, we ask you to upgrade to a subscription, which is essentially just to cover that cost of extended storage, because it is a lot of data that will continue to live. And we anticipate that most folks, once you finish the process and have your policy, you won't need that to continue to be stored anyway. So it is a $12 a year fee after the first year if you decide you'd like to continue access to your account. If not, you don't have to do anything. It will just be removed at some point.
And just to clarify, I mean, you can, once you get the document, you can save that anywhere. It's being able to access your data within the tool. So being able to access like your responses within the questionnaire itself that, the intention was that you would work on it for less than a year and export it and be done, and then it would be free. But there may be, if you are intending to continue to update the same policy on some set schedule on a relatively frequent basis, there you may want to keep it within the system and just do it there. Just to clarify that, like, it's not like after a year you lose your policy, you just lose the access to that functionality.
Right. That makes sense. Someone did ask that they're not able to use Google Drive where they work. So they're asking if there's an MS Word export option or any other workaround that you guys might know of in case, because I know that some facilities, especially if they're feds, can't get into the Google suite. So do you guys have any workarounds for that or any thoughts on that?
That's a good question. That was our developer's recommendation. We were hoping for a Word export, but I guess because it's proprietary that was not something that they could just add easily. So I suppose that a workaround would be, and this is a great question, because maybe we can add this workaround to as an addition to the website. So I know there are some programs where you can just convert any PDF into an editable document. So I possibly a just exporting the PDF straight and then converting that document somehow into editable. There might be some wonky formatting, I would imagine, but I think just going straight from the PDF and taking that text would be the workaround.
I think, just because I deal with Google Drive a decent amount too, that if you get into Google Drive, you can save it as a doc. Like you can do file export as a .doc if you need to. This is like the ultimate workaround, which we're probably getting way too techie right now. But if you wanted to, you could work on it on the web, get home, log in, get it as a Google document, export it as a doc, then bring it back to work if you're able to do that and open it up. Now, I will say, kind of like what you said, Alanna, there might be some wonky formatting. So you might be in there kind of, you know, messing around with spacing, and there might be some random characters that you're like, that's not what I wrote. That's like a diphthong. But at the same time, like, so there's some of that, but I think that might be a slight workaround that you can do if you needed to. And there's programs, like people are saying in the chat, you can open up PDFs in Word and they may lose some formatting. So I think you'd be running into a formatting issue than anything else. I feel like the good old days of hacking into all sorts of things is like, it's still around, unfortunately, where you're trying to find these converters of like who has what and who can do what. And it's not back in the good old battle days of when I was an undergrad, when it was like everyone shared the same floppy of WordPerfect and shared it around everywhere. So so someone asked, how many multiple users on an account are allowed? We are working with a committee of more than two or three people. So is there a maximum number of people who are allowed in the account?
There is no max. I asked that question of the developer, and she said, you know, if you're getting into the hundreds, then it might be start to slow down a bit. But there is no max. And when you do add users, you have the option to add them either as an administrator or an editor. Both have full access to edit the policy. The administrator role just can also add other users. So you can restrict that access to add more folks, but just making someone an editor.
Perfect. This is interesting. Can one policy be used for several kinds of collections, i.e. artifacts, paper archives, et cetera? It did seem like you guys had a customizable thing in there that you could say different collections, didn't you?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, as long as the collections are under the same umbrella to some extent, you know, like repository wise, multiple different types of materials, media can be included.
Let's see what else we have on here. How often will CCAHA review and update the toolkit? Are there any plans to update and review it? I know it's still pretty new. It's November 2022, right? Is when you guys said it was live.
So we, content language-wise, we don't unfortunately have a set plan for that. Our grant funding has concluded, and we are committed to sustaining this as a program. We're still paying, you know, not to get into the weeds, but we are still working with the web developers to, you know, make sure it stays up and running from just the kind of the use perspective. But I think updating language would probably happen on a case-by-case basis if for some reason our staff or even a user were to come to us and say, like, hey, thinking in the field has really changed on this topic. We really need to revisit it. I mean, we could update content at any time. It is meant to be fair. The content that is in there, the language that is in there, is meant to be pretty evergreen at this point. It doesn't get into topics that are changing super quickly. Like, I mean, there's a little, it touches very briefly on like digital collections and, but it doesn't, it's not a digital preservation policy. It's not the kind of thing where tools and systems and practices are gonna change on like an annual basis. I hope that kind of answered the question.
Yeah, I mean, I can say that jokingly, it's like, I've been 17 years in this biz now. And I can say like the language in CMPs is not, there's been differences. There have been changes and updates when it comes to maybe areas that are really, we've all known about things like repatriation, maybe language, maybe, you know, and I mean, like all that kind of areas are updating, but the guts of it, what you guys outlined, it seems to be, like you said, pretty evergreen. So that's good. And again, if you can get it in that Google version, you can change it and, you know, adapt it if you're an institution, if you need to. I'm going to finish up with this one question because it's kind of a bigger question. What are the differences between a CMP and an IPM management policy, which we'll talk about in a second because those are two different documents. But outside of that, because IPM is integrated pest management, which really deals with the pest management of your institution and is usually a separate document outside of the collection management policy. But with the advent of D-Plan 2.0, right? Are there any other thoughts, or even I'll ask our audience, are there any thoughts of what other kind of documents would you like to see in this kind of format of these plug and play, which seem pretty useful, right, to an institution? So do you guys have any thoughts, or are there any plans for other of these big policies to have formats like this, or have you guys heard of anything like it?
I will say we don't have anything actively in the works right now. I think we're still, as you mentioned, this did just come out, you know, a bit over 6 months ago. So we're still kind of in the discovery phase of having this tool out in the world. Just to kind of see what responses we're getting and what kind of requests there might be for similar types of things, you know, in related areas. I mean, I could see many policies or even, you know, procedural type documents fitting into this format like this. I think one lesson learned is that while I think, you know, Alanna and I both mentioned multiple times, we tried as much as we could to make this as customizable as possible and as, you know, possible to like tailor it to your particular cases as possible. But that, like, the cascading numbers of different ifs, ands, or buts just really quickly. So, I mean, my first thought with pests, integrated pest management plan is, oh my gosh, how many different kinds of pests could we build into accounting for their care and prevention in a policy like this? So that's just, you know, the caveat is being aware that the more customizable something is, I think the more time it's going to take to build it out. But I definitely could see different applications for a similar process, because I mean, as was kind of part of our intention with this, the basic recommendations, the basic bones are fairly consistent across institution, and even given all of those specifications and everything, it's like we preservation is a physical consideration, so that we're gonna have similar recommendations and similar even needs and whatnot across different collections. So sorry, I started rambling there.
No, you're fine. I mean, I think it is interesting. People are in here kind of saying, number one, they're saying thank you. And that a couple people are users and they're saying, this has been incredibly helpful. So they really appreciate the help. I'm seeing lots of that. I've also saw some floaty clappy hands, which I always enjoy seeing those whenever the live Zoom programs happen. People are putting examples of plans though, like strategic plans and things like that, which I could see some of those maybe being in this format. But I think the key thing that you said about this plan, this, you know, kit, and then also like D-Plan or any of those, is that they're great jumping off points, right? You put your information in, you read it, and you say, hey, this is a great place to start. Then you can start going in there and kind of crafting it to make sure it matches your governing structure, your facility, your all these kind of things. It's just a nice jumping off point. So I think that's something that everyone should remember. Definitely use these tools out here, because you guys are great. You went to the experts for it. I mean, my gosh, the names on your guys' list, I was like, yes, those are the experts in our field, right? So you went to wonderful people and knowledgeable people in the field to do it. But I don't think anyone would recommend that you just put all your information, hit print, and like put it on the shelf and walk away, right? Like, that's not how these things work. There's still a little bit of you going through it and needing to review it and make sure it applies to your institution, and that it'll work. That's a huge point of that. So I just want everyone to kind of remember that within the tools as well.
That also made me think, and I know we're like at and over time, but I did, while we're talking about like this is not the end all product, I just want to make sure we had an attorney write us a statement on the website to this effect, but this this, the what the product that you get, the policy that you get, still needs as full and comprehensive review and approval as anything that was fully written in-house would as well. It's we had an attorney write us language on the website, but we obviously are not having attorneys, or let alone your board members, reading each policy that is being spit out. So, you know, that take all of that to the level that you need to.
Yeah, exactly. Like that review process, and that you guys really owning it and learning it. I say you guys, I mean, like everyone who uses your product. That's what makes these things living documents. And that's what makes them useful for your institution, right? Like in the grand scheme of things. So, but you guys have created such a wonderful jumping off point that it's truly appreciated. You can see all the work that went into it to cover all those, the fun chapters you see in John Simmons' book and all that kind of stuff. Like you can see it broken down into what it is. So thank you again. Well, I'm going to go ahead and conclude today's program. Thank you so much, Dyani. Thank you, Alanna. That was a wonderful overview. I have been putting a link to the resources, which includes a copy of this presentation and the survey for this webinar. So please complete those if you can. Surveys are always appreciated. We are an IMLS supported program, so we really appreciate any kind of surveys that we do to kind of, you know, change our program for the future to make sure everyone is using it properly and enjoying it. So please let us know. Thank you again to IMLS, FAIC. Thank you to you all at CCAHA. It's always a pleasure to present with you all because you guys make such great, wonderful things. So thank you. And we will see you all for our summer programming starting in July. Please go to our website and register. So thank you again. And we will see you all in about a month. So thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks. Okay.